What's up, y'all? This is D Munoz, and you're checking out my boy, David Duane.
What's going on, everybody? Thank you for tuning back into On Air with the one and only rockstar, the Mike, David Duane, in the place to be. And right here and right now, we've got our boy, pop and R&B singer, D Munoz, on with us. Listen, guys, if you don't know who D is, guess what? D just dropped his brand new EP called Moments, featuring his latest singles, Drink, Comfort, and Type of Love. And guess what? You guys can also check out those videos on YouTube right now. And guess what? D is also getting ready to go on tour next week with Ali Brooke, and he's joining with us. What's going on, D?
What's up? How's everybody feeling?
Listen, we're feeling good, and especially feeling great to, you know, have you on the show, because, I mean, man, you have been making serious moves over the last, you know, couple years. So I want to say congratulations, because all your moves have been big, you know, big moves. Thank from, you know, really utilizing your social media and really pushing your talent, and then, you know, getting with your management team and then signing to Epic. Like, everything has just been going, like, pretty quick and dope for you, I would say. It's been a journey.
Yeah, it's been falling in place, you know. Sometimes I find myself being impatient, wanting it faster, but I'm starting to love the process.
Exactly. And what's kept you grounded and kept you patient, you know, as you know, with the process and everything?
What's kept me patient is my team, for sure. Shayna, of course, she's always making fun of me, keeping me grounded, telling me, you know, that it's a marathon. Wayno, also in my ear, just keeping me grounded and everything. And yeah, just my team, my family, my friends, and everybody on the label, honestly. Like, I could go to the label and ask them for advice. So it's been cool. I got some good people around me.
Absolutely. And that's amazing. And you're from New Jersey, and being in a single parent household, having that family dynamic, how has that been always for you to, you know, just kind of be so close to your family, you know, as you, you know, go along in this business and honestly learn the business too, as you, you know, reach higher peaks?
It kept me close to the family and helped me learn, because I feel like I had to grow up faster, you know. Mm-hmm. Growing up with a single mom, that means you got to be the man of the house at a certain age. So, you know, just maturing faster, and yeah, just the family around me pushing me to work for what I want and make sure that I chase my dreams, and my mom being in my ear, supporting me 100%. My brother basically built, you know, what we had before we went to the label together. So yeah, just having them around me has helped a lot.
For sure, D. And I think it's actually amazing, because even with you and your brother, like, the dynamic that you guys have and him supporting you as far as putting the visuals together and you guys making sure that, you know, these videos for, you know, your songs are amazing, and then the videos for your covers are, like, absolutely A1. Like, you guys really have teamed up and done something amazing. The quality has stayed so consistent. So keeping consistency from being independent, yeah, and being signed with a major, how has that been? Because I know that sometimes can be very difficult. Some people don't understand that your quality of your art has to be A1 all the time, but you've kept that, yeah, same consistency going. And I can definitely love and respect that a lot.
Yeah, we were big on that. Like, I didn't put out my first video till I was 18. I had started music when I was 15, but we were just big on quality over quantity. Mm-hmm. We wanted to make sure the content, everything was good. We were very big on that. So even with my first visual, like, we could have went to, you know, a more affordable place, but we just said, nah, we're going to save up for a year and we're going to put it towards a music video. That's exactly what we did. And then we just kept it consistent from there, you know, with keeping a certain type of image for my brand.
Right. And I know that, speaking of image was something that, you know, your image did change as you progressed. Was that something that was very difficult for you to just kind of fit into your own style as far as, like, wardrobe was concerned, and then genre-wise, because you went from, you know, doing more so R&B to now pop, which is honestly, I feel like it works for you because you can really get diverse. You can add this, the Spanish flavor to it. You know, you can still be soulful as well, too.
It wasn't really hard. I feel like even with my pop stuff, I still bring my R&B sound to it. I still do R&B, you know, here and there. It's just like a mixture now. So it hasn't really been hard. And then image wise, I'm just who I am. You know, that's never really changed. I guess, you know, I just started putting together better outfits.
I mean, don't we all, once we get older, from going from, you know, yeah, 15, then to 18, and then once we reach our 20s, it's like our outfits start to look better. It's like he actually took time to color coordinate. It wasn't like brown and gray and orange, yeah, going on, even though, you know, those colors could work. I respect those that are, you know, bold in that color scheme. Yeah. But once you start putting it all together as you get older, it makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, I feel like it's all coming together really, really well now, you know? everything.
Yeah, especially with this the single Drink. Like, it's really coming together. I mean, the streams online, it's just freaking phenomenal with this record. And, you know, this is really upbeat for this record. What was the approach of it? Because a lot of people aren't really catching on the fact that you're not actually talking about you drinking. A girl is trying to make you drink.
Why are you the first person? You're the first person to catch on to that.
Listen, real recognizes real music.
Yeah. So the approach. So basically, my friends Connor produced it. Riley Castle and Toby co-wrote it. So Connor and Riley, they're like about 25. They've never drinking before.
And I'm
not of age to drink. So we came up with this idea of, you know, let's make a record of a girl trying to make us drink. You know, I feel like nobody really talks about that. It's usually the guy trying to get to drink. But yeah, that was the idea of the record. And a lot of people don't get it on the first try. But as soon as I explain it to them, they're like, oh, okay. And I got you now.
Right. And what was so symbolic to kind of switch the narrative around? Because like you said, a lot of times it's the male trying to get the woman to drink type of thing. But what made you kind of go in a different direction?
Just personal experience with Connor and Riley. Them guys never drinking. I think Riley actually experienced the moment where a girl actually was trying to make him drink at a bar somewhere. So yeah, just their personal experience helped bring the idea together.
Wow. Yeah, personal experience definitely helps. And would you say with your writing, I've heard with this project, it's been a little bit more personal for the writing side for you, right?
Yeah, yeah, on certain records, yeah.
So what was that energy that you really had to tap into to kind of get a little bit more personal with this EP versus the first project that you dropped?
I think it was more so the same with when it comes to the whole tapping in, but I think I just grew more lyrically and vocally, so it was easier for me to get the message across, and I was able to dig deeper. And then with this project, you know, I was going through a couple of things in the mix of making it, so that helped more. But definitely just the experience that I was going through, all the sessions that were making me better with my writing and singing and bringing an idea to life. I feel like it was the same thing with both projects. I just got better.
Right. I love Comfort. That's definitely like
that's one of the top three
on there, especially, and that's track three. Top three favorite, and that's track three. And that's something else right there. I just noticed I just said that. And that seems to be really getting a great response from the fans with that record.
Yeah.
What was for those who haven't heard it, you know, kind of walk them through that record too.
So basically, Comfort is like my breakup song, me breaking up with a young lady. Basically, I'm telling her, you know, I've been treating you wrong for a long time. I've been holding on to you because I'm scared to be alone. But, you know, now it's time that I man up and I just can't hold on to you for comfort. So, you know, I'm just breaking down to her why I'm, you know, and how it's going to hurt me to leave you and stuff. So, yeah, that was very personal joint right there.
Right. And have you gone through that yet, or were you just kind of writing from, you know, somebody else?
No, yeah, that was literally something I was going to.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I went into the studio. They asked me, hey, are you, like, the thing when I go into the studio with other writers, they ask me, all right, how are you feeling? What are you going through? Is there anything you want to talk about? So as soon as I came in, I knew exactly what I wanted to speak about. I knew exactly what type of vibe I wanted to be on. So, you know, we got in, I told them what I was going through, and we just made magic.
That's amazing. And touching on vulnerability with, you know, your style of music, mixed fusing pop and R&B and diving personal, do you feel like it's a safe space in music for men to do that now? Or do you kind of feel like men are now really shying away? Because we're getting a little bit of mixture when it comes to like music nowadays. You know, we don't know if the guy wants to be vulnerable or if he wants to be hard. It's like it's a little bit of confusion, I would say.
Yeah, I feel like vulnerability is a big thing, you know, that might have slowly drifted away, but I feel like it's there with certain artists, you know, like you got a Black, you got the Tory Lanez of the world, the Eric Bellingers, you know, who still make that type of R&B music. But I feel like vulnerability is a big thing, and I feel like people definitely miss that type of music. So when it comes to me, I've always been vulnerable in my music. I feel like, you know, people connect better when it comes to that.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like there's nothing better than touching people with your lyrics and everything. So, yeah, I love vulnerability.
Exactly. And touching vulnerability with your lyrics, your fans are very supportive. And they, you know, get to see you come and go on tour with Ally Brooke in a couple of days.
Yeah.
So, you know, getting ready for that tour. What's the preparation for, like, you know, just a show, a tour, you know, just the whole experience with you?
Oh, well, I got back in the gym because I'm be taking my shirt off. but, you know, getting back in the gym, doing some cardio. I've been doing a little bit of boxing in the gym so I could get my breathing up. I have vocal rehearsals coming up. I got rehearsals with, you know, do a little bit of choreography and everything. But just that type of stuff. And then mentally, I think, you know, keeping a clear mind and just being excited for what's to come.
Yeah, that's amazing. And how important is fitness for preparing for a show? I think a lot of people think that you can just go out there, do one show, maybe do two, maybe do five, and not really, you know, prepare properly as far as your vocals are concerned. And, you know, that you're, you know, physically fit for it.
Yeah, I think it's very important because there's been times where I haven't, honestly, recently it happened to me. We were doing a couple shows in Florida, and prior to going down there, I hadn't really sung in like a week. You know, I wasn't rehearsing, I wasn't doing anything. So when we did the first show, I could feel that I didn't have my breath, my breathing, and, you know, that I wasn't 100% there. So I feel like, you know, preparing is very important, especially when you're going on tour and you have a bunch of dates. Because, you know, at the end of the day, you got to give the fans a show. You know, mm-hmm. they're paying to see you perform and everything. So I feel like you got to prepare. You got to be 100% so you can give them what they want to see.
Exactly. And being 100%, I've known you've headlined shows before yourself, especially being from the tri-state area. What experience will you be taking from, you know, your headline experience to, you know, opening for Allie for this tour?
I'll just be taking, you know, what I usually do, just being myself, interacting, singing picking people out of the crowd and just doing all that stuff and being myself. You know, I look at it like a show is a show, headliner mm-hmm. or not. So, you know, I'm going to treat me being the opener as me being the headliner, you know, and I'm going to just go out there and do what I got to do and give it my all.
Exactly. And that's what you got to do. You know, just kind of give it your all and give that focus, because that's what, you know, the fans want to see. Consistency.
Yeah.
And you've been bringing that. So I want to also talk about social media a little bit more and just being able to connect with your fans. I popped in where you've talked to your fans on lives and just keeping them up to date. How important is that? Because a lot of, you know, I would say creatives our age and a little bit older don't understand that using social media is very important. So they might post an update and they're like, okay, forget about it. But you're really consistent with that. You even know your fans' names. You've met them multiple times. So how important is it to keep that that consistency and stay in touch with them?
I think it's very important because, you know, you're building a fan base. And to build a fan base, you have to connect. I've always said, like, I've seen people go on my live and they say, oh, you know, when you get bigger, you're going to stop talking to us. And I'm like, I mean, the point of going live is to talk to y'all. You know,
mm-hmm.
that's what I like. When I see people go live and they're literally sitting in front of the phone, but they're not talking to nobody. They're looking at the comments. They're not talking to nobody. I just find it very pointless.
Right.
And I look at going live as a way to connect. That's an easy way to just say, all right, let me just talk to a couple people, see how they're feeling, you know, and yada, yada. And, you know, people really appreciate that, you know, and it goes a long way, even if, like, you feel like it doesn't. That's what makes the fans connect. That's what makes them really want to go 100% for you. And yeah, I just feel like connecting is a big, big important thing when it comes to building a fan base, a hardcore fan base, because that's what's gonna make you win in your career. So yeah, I feel like it's very important getting on social media and talking to your supporters.
Yeah, it's definitely important, because even if you want to, in order to keep your fans too, you know, like,
exactly, that's what keeps them, you know.
Because if you don't interact, they'd be like, oh, this person hasn't gone live with us. They have totally disregarded, like, us, like, we don't exist. Because people see the shift. I work with artists, and I see where they've gone from interaction to no interaction to actually not posting at all. And I'm just like, wait a minute. How are we going to keep this brand going and, you know, keep people interested into what the music is, especially if you've been, you know, such this guy or girl that they love? You know, personality is everything, I say. And you definitely have that. And that's what your fans love about you the most. And I think that's what is going to, you know, definitely help you and keep you going further with, you know, life and stuff like that in your career.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah.
So now signing with Epic, how has that experience been? For those who don't know how the whole story came about, you know, kind of tell them what happened, because I think it's really dope.
The way I got with Epic, we got to backtrack a little bit. I met my manager in Walmart. So one day I'm strolling through Walmart. I see my manager. I know who he is because he was managing somebody that I was a fan of at the time. So I go up to him, I introduce myself, and I ask him if I could send him some music. He says, yeah, he gives me his email. I send him some records. I don't hear back from him, but he follows me on Instagram. So I'm just like, okay, you know, I won't let it slow me down. I just continue to do what I'm doing, putting out records. I was on my way to put out my first music video. So a year passed. He contacts me. He tells me how he likes what I'm doing and everything. So he asked me if I need help. I told him, yeah, I need some help right now. and yeah, you know, I think that was the beginning of 2018. We were looking, shopping around for deal opportunities. We had a few, and then we went to Epic, and we felt like that was the best situation for me. And we ended up signing there, and the rest is history.
Wow, that's amazing. And then just receiving the type of feedback that you got from Sylvia, and being as legendary as she is, what was that feeling? Because a lot of people don't get that chance of, you know, coming across her desk at all and meeting her.
Yeah, it was a great feeling. I won't act like I knew who she was at first.
Mm-hmm.
Wayno was kind of the one explaining to me, like, yo, that's legendary that she, you know, she really likes you and everything. So with time, I started to really realize how big the situation was, and I started to appreciate it more. And it just made me feel excited to have someone so powerful, you know, in my corner and believe in me.
Yeah, that's amazing. And I'm sure once you finally realize who she was, stuff like that, and just who she's worked with and who she's, you know, what label she's been with, that kind of like was a wow feeling for you.
Yeah, 100%.
Man, that's exciting.
Yeah, it was.
So, D, what's next? I know that the EP's out, the tour. Are you going to be dropping more music this year, more videos for the project? What's next to come? Because I see you've got the video series on YouTube, which is incredible. If everybody hasn't watched it, you need to go to D's YouTube channel and follow it. But what's next for you?
What's next for D Munoz? We do have one more video coming this week, and I haven't told anybody, but, you know, we'll let the people know. So we have a video coming this week.
So that means I can guess it, right?
No.
I always like to slide a little curveball in there, like, can I guess it?
Yeah. So, yeah, we have a video coming this week. We have the tour coming next week. And we're just trying to, you know, stay busy, stay on the road, record some more music, and, you know, we'll see. Hopefully, we drop some more fire this summer. I don't know, but, you know, just trying to stay busy.
Exactly. Do you think that you'll probably be on tour this summer as well? Because I know that's a big question a lot of your fans have been asking too.
Yeah, that's the goal. You know, we're hoping that we get another big opportunity for the summer.
Absolutely. Fingers crossed, and hopefully we will all get a chance. Well, if they don't have tickets, they need to be getting tickets to, you know, your show with Allie right now. Tri-State sure. area. Well, D, thank you so much for this interview. Tell everybody where they can, you know, follow you as far as social media is concerned, and, you know, stream and download the project.
So you guys can follow me online at Official D Munoz, Official DMUNOZ. My project Moments is out. It's on all streaming platforms. You could go get that. And yeah, I appreciate y'all.
What's up, y'all? This is D Munoz, and you're checking out my boy David Duane.